All right, well, let's go ahead and turn to Genesis chapter 3. The title of this morning's message is A Tree in the Midst. I think about 2 weeks ago, the Lord put it on my heart to preach a message out of the garden narrative. And as I began to study yesterday and began to write the message, I began to realize that kind of like in the middle of everything that this had become a series and that it wasn't just a one-time sermon. So we'll see how it all works out for this morning, but let's go ahead and read the whole chapter of chapter 3. So we're in Genesis chapter 3, starting in verse 1. It says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, You shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, You shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou should not eat? And the man said, The woman thou gavest to be with me, she gave me the tree. She gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly thou shalt go, and dust thou shalt eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Not to change the subject, but it's like, you know, we live in the midst of women's lib time frame, and nobody ever wants to hear that passage of scripture that it says that a woman's to submit to her husband. Guess what, Eve? The proclamation came right there. It's in the word. It's in the It started in the garden. And part of the issue is that she, I believe anyway, and this doesn't have anything to do with my message this morning, but I just saw that and it hit me. Part of the issue is that she was deceived by the enemy, and that she did not listen to the proclamation that God had given her to begin with. And because of that, God has ordained this to be so. It doesn't matter. I'm not getting into what a man's supposed to do for his wife, and we understand what the Word of God says. That a man's to love his wife like Jesus loved the church. That's sacrificial and selfless. And men, most men don't do that. And we all are in the process of desiring to grow with the Lord. But what I just want to say is this, is that there's oftentimes contention in the midst of a home because neither person is wanting to submit to the word of the Lord. Amen. And neither person is wanting to do what it is that God has proclaimed and that God has ordained. Wow. A specific pathway, a specific way for things to be done. And the word of God is real clear right here that you're going to be in pain whenever you give birth to your children. And not only that, he's going to rule over you. And your desire is going to be for your husband, and he will rule over you. That's the way that it is. It doesn't matter that times change. It doesn't matter that women have jobs now. It doesn't matter that they pay their taxes. That's not the issue. There's a spiritual issue at hand here. And the problem that we all have is with authority. In each and every one of our lives, in some way, shape, or form, we have a problem with authority. Whether it was Matt's problem with the police force, whether it was a child's problem with their mommy and their daddy, whether it's a husband's problem with the way, husband's problem with submitting himself properly to God, whether it's a wife's problem submitting herself to her husband. And granted, I realize that a lot of times women say, you try to submit to that husband, preacher. Okay, I get it. I'm not trying to tell you everything's perfect, but we'll tell you this, that if you will be obedient to the part that God's asking you to do, he will move and give you grace in the midst of your circumstances. I believe that. Amen? I believe that. All right. Verse 17, and unto Adam he said, because you have hearkened unto the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for your sake. In sorrow you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. And Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothed them. And the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. Father, we just thank you for your precious word once again. And we ask you to have your way this morning, Lord, and that you'd speak to us through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Yes. Amen. And one of the things that I wanted to point out is that based upon the pictures I put on the screen is that, you know, in the beginning, you know, I talked about this Thursday night. What I did was I turned in my Bible and I said, this much of the Bible, I don't know if y'all were here Thursday night, but if you were, you would remember that. This much of the Bible talks about an earth that was created that had no sin in it. One page in this Gideon King James Bible, one page of the Bible speaks of an earth that had no sin in it. And all the rest of this is a story of redemption, a story of God's plan to bring humanity back. Whenever we look at the garden, the picture of a garden, we see the concept that there were two trees there. But when you go back to chapters 1 and 2, what we understand is that God had prepared a place, an environment. Specifically, when you look at creation separate from mankind, then yes, you see a powerful God and you see him creating all kinds of various things. But whenever you inject the idea that the rest of this story is all about redemption and all about God bringing mankind back to him and all about God desiring to have a relationship with man, then creation makes so much more sense, because you realize that God created to prepare a place for his prized creation to dwell. This earth is not God. In other words, what I'm trying to tell you is that it's called pantheism. That there's occultic concepts that say that Mother Earth is God. It's pagan idolatry. Wicca believes that kind of thing also. Witchcraft. And they believe that the earth is God's. And they're so consumed with a green earth. Listen, we shouldn't pollute it. We shouldn't destroy it. God gave it to us to take care of. But it's not God. And God doesn't live in the grass. God doesn't live in a flower. The flower's not God. God created it. He spoke it and caused it to sprout up. And it was created for his glory. Amen. Everything was created for Jesus and for his glory. Ultimately, yeah. This earth belongs to him. That's what the word of God says. But God had placed mankind in the midst of that garden to dwell there because God had a big old purpose. I'm telling you that whenever it's hard for us to see it, but God knew all along what was going to happen. And whenever you look back at those chapters and you see that God had created and he divided light from darkness. He divided waters from earth. He divided night and day. And he made different types of seeds and division of herbs and division of trees. And all of those herbs and all of those trees were there. And whenever God was done, he said, it's good. Everything that I've created is good. And then the word of God says that he rested. He rested on the seventh day. And this becomes what we would call the first Shabbat, the first rest, the first Sabbath. The concept of Sabbath was instituted long before there was ever an Israel, long before there was ever a law. And the reason that the day of rest came was not because God was worn out and weary and tired, but that instead God was implementing, see, his work was finished.
Amen.
His work was done. And so he rested. He had prepared an environment for Adam and Eve to dwell within. He had given Adam, when he saw that everything was good, he gave Adam a helpmeet so that they could procreate, because God ultimately had a plan that he was going to cause them to multiply upon the face of the earth. Because we know now, looking backwards, we have that liberty, we have that freedom to look backwards and realize God is creating an eternal family.
Amen.
God has a bigger plan on the horizon than what we see right here in the pages of these of the scriptures, that the plan that God has looks forward to something that's eternal. And at the same time, what we see in the narrative is that everything was good and God rested, but then his rest is interrupted. His rest is interrupted because of what happened in chapter 3. The word of God says that the change that took place when the serpent came into the garden resulted in a change not only to mankind, but it resulted also in a change to the earth. And that's why the picture of thorns and thistles is up there. So God had originally created and everything was perfect and everything was good, but then there's thorns and thistles. But once again, as I was telling you, we long for a day. The word of God says that we long for a day to know that the temporary is going to give way to the eternal. I was going to turn to 2 Peter chapter 3 real quick and just read a little bit of that passage to you. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. I'm actually going to probably read through verse 13. 2 Peter 3, verse 9 through 13. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise. What does that mean? It means he's not slow. He's not delaying. The reason Peter's saying this is because he said earlier in the same chapter, he said in the last days there's going to be scoffers. You know what a scoffer is? The person that whenever you tell them you're a Christian, they're like, they laugh at you, or they make a little funny sound at you under their breath. That's a scoffer. They think that what you believe is foolishness. He said in the last days that we're going to be scoffers regarding the word of God, regarding the plan of God. But Peter says that the Lord is not slack concerning his promise. They can scoff all they want to. It appears that he delays. It appears that he's slow. It appears maybe that he's lazy or that he can't get up and get the job done. That's not what he's doing. You can't think like a man thinks and think that the Lord is delaying or lazy, or he just don't want to get up and do what it is that he was called to do. That's what a man would think. Oh, well, what kind of God do you serve? Look how long he tarries. Look how long he waits. That's not what's going on. Instead, it says the conjunction, but is long-suffering towards us. You know, I've taught this word long-suffering quite a bit in when I speak of the lust of the flesh versus the fruit of the Spirit, but I think it's worth mentioning that the word long-suffering describes patience in relationships. You know, the fact of the matter is that there's some people on this earth, they're going to get on your nerves. They're going to cross some boundaries. They're going to do some things that they should not have done to you, and your response, at least if it was the old man, is either going to let them know real quick with your mouth, or nowadays with Facebook, with your mouth or with Facebook, where they did you wrong, what they did wrong, and you're going to let them know, oh no, you don't do me like that. Or if you're of the barbarian type and the old man comes up, you might just snatch him around his throat and sling him up against the wall and show him who the boss is. see, long-suffering is something that's given by the Holy Spirit. Long-suffering is patience in relationships. It's a fruit of the Spirit. It's not a fruit of Matt. And when the Holy Ghost shows up and you read the Word and you begin to understand what long-suffering is, the Holy Spirit says, I've been long-suffering with you.
Yes.
I'm not slack concerning my promise, but I'm long-suffering. I delayed a little bit longer to wait for you. For you to get your heart right. For you to get your life right. And yet somebody does you wrong. Well, you don't think they did me wrong, he would say? As they pulled the whiskers out of my beard, as they thrust the crown of thorns on my head, and as they hung me on the cross and they ridiculed me. No, they did me wrong. And you can't even allow my Holy Spirit to bridle your tongue. To throttle it. To hold it down. Listen to me. I'm preaching to myself. The fact of the matter is that there's something in each and every one of us that wants to let people know about how their business is. And sometimes there's a right place and a right season for everything. You got to remember something. Just as I was talking to somebody before the service, that they have given their notice at their job. And yet at the same time, there's something in them that compels them to make sure that they communicate to their current boss exactly what's going on and give them ample time to find a replacement if that's what they want to do, even though the person hadn't treated them right. He's not going to do a Johnny paycheck on them. Take this job and shove it. He's not going to do that. Why? Because of the fact that Jesus lives on the inside of him.
Praise
this
God.
Ain't got nothing to do with my message, but the Lord wanted me to stop on long-suffering and let you know. He's long-suffering towards you. He's not slack. He waited for you to come around. Hallelujah. And now he wants you to go ahead and be long-suffering towards somebody else. Do you realize, man, Robert used to say it all the time. Can you go back to Burger King and tell them about your Jesus? What you talking about, Robert? Yeah, I saw you when you went through the drive-thru. I was behind you the other day. And when you went through there, that girl couldn't get your order right. Somebody said, can you go back to Smoothie King, Matt? Well, I hope so. I sure try not to be rude to people, even though sometimes it's like, can you not hear me? Do you need to change your intercom? I don't know how much louder I can talk. But the point is that sometimes we get so aggravated, so frustrated, that we make a hiney out of ourselves.
That's right.
I already cleared it this morning. Everybody said hiney was okay. And we make a hiney out of ourselves. And you know what? That's not long suffering. So how do I start, preacher? Well, guess what? Jesus died on the cross so that the fruit of the Spirit of long suffering could be produced in your
that's
life.
Right.
And when you realize you don't have it, that's when you cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, give me long suffering. Amen?
Amen?
I mean, if you want it,
right.
You don't have to want it.
Amen.
You can just sit there and tighten up your jaw, stiffen your neck, say, no, I don't want it. I want to be mad. I want to be angry. I want to be bitter. Bitterness will destroy you.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Won't it?
Yeah.
It will.
Yeah.
The enemy loves bitterness. Yeah. He loves to inject it in his people's hearts and in God's people's hearts to turn them, blame it, everything on everybody else. Just like Adam's. It says right here, it says that it went back to long-suffering to us, Lord. Not willing that any should perish. That's why he was long-suffering, because he doesn't want people to perish, but that instead they should all come to repentance. So the Lord waits just a little bit longer for people to come around. But he goes on to say, we're getting to the point, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. This current earth that we live upon, that was originally created pristine and without sin, but because of the fall started to grow thorns and thistles, will one day at the end burn up and will be dissolved through heat. And it goes on to say, verse 11, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in all holy conversation and godliness? In other words, your conversation, your walk, your life. What kind of a person should you be to understand that this world that you live on that grows thorns and thistles is one day going to be dissolved? It goes on to say in verse 12, looking for and hastening hasting, waiting urgently unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Amen. The point that I wanted to make with all that right there was this. It was that the fall of man, God had rested, God had created. Everything that God had created was good, but then interrupted his rest was when the serpent came into the garden, and all of a sudden temptation gives way to sin, and all of a sudden everything changes. Not only his creation, but the entire environment changes, and it starts to grow thorns and thistles, but it is also prepared a, I don't want to say playground, that's not a good word, it's prepared an environment to allow the story to move forward, to allow God's redemptive purposes, and for the rest of this book that's being written, that has been written, sorry, to move forward, and so that we can, that God can bring humanity to the place that he desires to, in order for that eternal family to come together. Now the interesting thing is, and many of you have heard me use this passage of scripture out of 1 Peter 1:18, that none of this took God by surprise. The truth, if the truth be told, God knew that the fall was going to take place before he ever created the heavens and the earth.
Yes, he did.
And we know that from the New Testament scripture that we're about to read. This morning's message in the garden is specifically about temptation. Next week's message, I think, will be specifically about sin. And then the next week's message will be specifically about the plan to bring us back to restoration. But what I want you to know is this, is that not only do we see a New Testament passage that tells us that God already knew, because somebody that doesn't believe in the Bible, they could easily say, oh yeah, but Peter just said that afterwards. He just threw that in there. No, God already in the Old Testament, thousands of years before, whenever he clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of an animal, whenever he spoke a proclamation to the serpent, the seed of the woman will crush your head. God had already told us that redemption was on the way. And in this passage of scripture, it says in 1 Peter 1:18, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed, which means to be purchased back, with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation, or your empty life is what that really would mean, received by the tradition of your from your fathers. You received an empty life from the tradition of your fathers. Did you know that? Your folks, if they didn't teach you how to live for Jesus, taught you a bunch of worldliness, and it's not trying to pick on them. They just taught you a world's culture. They didn't know any better. And it was vain. It was empty. And it was the tradition, specifically speaking to Israel too, that some of their traditions were empty and vain and did not lead to Christ. Now, all of the stuff that God gave Moses was pointing them towards Jesus, right? And so it says right here in verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ. You weren't redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold, but instead you were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb, without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. So it says right there, he was foreordained. The lamb, his precious blood, the redemption of his precious blood to buy you back, was foreordained before the earth was ever founded. God already had a plan of redemption in place before the word ever spoke and the spirit hovered and creation took place. But whenever God stopped, amen, and said, it is good, everything that I've done is good, before the serpent ever slithered into the garden, God already knew that it was going to happen. God already knew that man was going to fall. God was not taken by surprise. Instead, I'm telling you, I believe this. I can't prove it to you, but I believe it. God knew that in order for there to be a free will, there had to be a real choice. It's not his perfect will that man fall. It's not his perfect will that man deviate and go down the wrong path. But in order for there to be a true free will exercise, there must truly be a choice. And God allowed a choice to be made from the very beginning. And from that time frame until the end, there will always be a choice. And we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. Back to Genesis chapter 3. Well, actually, I'm sorry. You can hold your finger in Genesis chapter 3. I wanted to go real quick to 1 John. Or you can go. I'm just going to read it to you. 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. One of the things that I wanted to say about temptation, because that's what we're talking about this morning. is that it says right here in verse 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passes away, once again talking about a temporary nature, and the lust thereof, temporary, but he that does the will of God abides forever. It says, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. One of the first things that I noticed about temptation is that it engages our senses. Whenever you look at the lust of the eyes, it's the sense of vision. And any temptation that's ever going to come your way in some way, shape, or form is going to enter in through. You're going to be able to see it. But not only that, other senses, you may not always see it, but you're going to feel it some kind of way, whether it become through your auditory senses, your tactile, your taste, your smell. When I mean by tactile, I mean touch. You know, whenever you touch something, it either feels good or it feels bad. And the truth of the matter is that you don't want to touch something. Whenever you grab a hold of a thorn stem, a rose's stem, and the thorn sticks you, you don't really want to snatch a hold of those things anymore and rip your hands across it. It doesn't feel good. It hurts. God gave us senses in order to engage our physical world. You know, the truth of the matter is that our senses can be used for both pleasure and safety. God gave us bitter taste buds in order for us to realize that what we're eating may not be good for us. That could be poisonous. At the same time, whenever I eat my mother-in-law's pork roast, it's not, my senses aren't, they're not working right. Because it's telling me, this is so good. Oh, this is so good, I got to give me some more of this. But if I go on and eat that pork roast, I'm telling you right now, that thing's got, look, this might gross you out. That thing's got a layer of fat on it like that. Sometimes we just kind of take our finger and we cut that fat off and we eat it with the skin, bro. And I'm talking about you, that's the best thing you ever put in your mouth. I'm telling you, it is so good. But if I ate that every day of my life, the next thing you know, my whole heart and all my arteries are going to be clogged up. So sometimes my senses are deceiving me. I can remember one time I was on a job in Jay, Florida. And they said, it was an H2S job. And they said, listen to me, you got all these alarms, you got all these things, but listen, don't let your nose, don't deny your nose. Don't trust the alarms. Right. If you smell sulfur, get out and let us examine the situation to make sure everything's okay. Because your nose is only going to work for a short period of time. Because that sulfur is going to, it's going to mess up your olfactory senses. You're smelling, and you're not going to be able to smell it anymore before long. And H2S gas will kill you, boy. And so God will use your senses. He gave them to you to engage the physical world, but they can be used for safety. They can also be used for pleasure. And I just want you to know that temptation comes through your senses because we live in a physical world, and that's how the enemy is going to try to engage you in the midst of temptation. And one of the things that I was thinking about is the fact that Eve and Jesus were both tempted according to their physical senses. In the lust of the eye, whenever Eve ultimately looked at the tree, she realized that it offered something that was going to be pleasant. When she saw it, it was something that was pleasant to look upon. And I can tell you that the enemy of your soul is not going to send something to you that doesn't look pleasant to you. In other words, now what looks pleasant to you may not look pleasant to me. I don't know. But whenever the enemy brings a temptation your way, he's going to make sure that it looks good to you. And I'm going to be honest with you. The fact of the matter is that what looked good to you 15 years ago may not look good to you today. But there's still something. And what I mean by that is, and I'm not just talking only physical appearance on that situation. But the fact is that before you were ever changed, a long, long time ago, when your sinful nature was ruling and reigning in your heart, I'll be honest with you, I'm kind of ashamed to admit it. It just didn't really matter whether it was real pleasant to my eyes or not. If it was something that I wanted to go get because I thought it was going to make my flesh feel good, I went and got it. And it didn't really matter how good it looked. It didn't matter how bad it looked. It didn't matter whatever the case. If it was going to make me feel good, I just wanted it. Well, after a period of time, as the Lord began to change me, as the Word of God began to reinculturate me, my concept of what looked good, my concept of what felt good began to change. But I need you to understand something also. I may say this multiple times this morning. The enemy of your soul has been observing human behavior for a long time. You understand what I'm saying? The enemy of your soul is a celestial creation that surpasses your intelligence by eons. You think he's dumb. He ain't dumb. He's sitting around waiting. That's why Mick Jagger sang that song, because he was a Luciferian. And he sang that song. I don't remember. I think the name of the song is Ode to Satan, actually. And you wouldn't even know what the song is about, other than he says, what's bothering you is the nature of my game. And what he's talking about is the deception with which he practices. And he talked about the fact that he's been here for a long, long time. He said, I was there when Pontius Pilate washed his hands. See, he's been observing. Ooh, I felt that right there. He's been observing human behavior for a long time. And I'm telling you right now, he knew what you used to like. He watched you. And listen, sometimes, even after you give your heart to Jesus, he keeps pulling the plug. He keeps pulling the same old little string. And many times we, like a little puppy dog, just go running right to it. And the fact is that whenever the Lord starts to get a hold of you, don't think that he quits watching. As a matter of fact, in the Greek language, whenever the Word of God says that the tempter left Jesus, it doesn't mean that he just left. No, it meant he backed away and he waited for a more opportune time. He's got patience. He's waiting. He's been observing. He's been observing human behavior. He knew what you liked before Jesus, and now he's been watching you since you gave your heart to Jesus. Right. And he knows also, look, I'm telling you, he's sly. And so I wanted you to see that it's the lust of the eye. It's going to be pleasant to look upon. It's going to be something that looks right. It's going to be something that looks good. It's going to be pleasing to you. He did the same thing to Jesus. He showed him the kingdoms of the earth. Now, you know, to Jesus, to you and I, maybe the kingdoms of the earth, it almost seems hard to wrap my mind around. You know, I don't see myself in royal regal, wearing a crown and having like the staff, you know. I don't see the enemy showing me the kingdoms of the earth. You know, I mean, yes, he shows people power and fortune and everything. And it depends on what it is, once again, that looks good to you. But that was the temptation that was given to Jesus. He was able to see what he was manifest for as a king. He was manifest to be the King of Kings. He was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But the first time he came lowly and riding on a donkey. And you know, the enemy of your soul, he knows, once again, exactly what it is that's going to get you. Whether it's a cookie, a crack, whether it's whatever it may be. He knows. He's been observing. You need to understand, he's sly. He's smart. And so he will appeal to the eye. He also appeals to the flesh. It says that she found out it was good for food. When she realized that the tree was good for food, it ultimately was part of her decision making to go ahead and grab a hold of it and to partake of it. Now, one of the things about the flesh regarding Jesus was that he was hungry. It said, turn the stones into bread. I think for the first time that I ever saw this, and I don't want to really get too ahead of myself, but I will say this, that hunger, whenever we took our nutrition class, I'm pretty sure that David and Sean would remember this. I mean, not that you had to take our nutrition class to know this word, but there was a big word that I had never heard. It's not a big word, but it was a word that I had never heard of before, and they made us learn that word in nutrition, satiety. It's another way to say satisfaction. It's descriptive of your appetite. Whenever you're hungry for something, then you're not full. And so you eat until you have reached satiety, until you're satisfied. And within this concept, I just want you to hold on to that word for a second. Jesus was hungry. And the offer was for him to take his power and to create, to turn stones into bread. And then ultimately also, we also tempted in this last aspect right here with the pride of life. With her and the tree, the desire was to be wise. It was a wisdom that was being offered that wasn't offered by God. She's left to feel like she's missing out on something. She's left to feel like God didn't give her everything that it was that she really needed. And there's just like an emptiness there. For some reason, this tree has something that she has to get. And if she gets it, it's going to fill her up. It's going to put something on the inside of her that's going to make her feel better, going to make her feel more complete, make her feel fulfilled. And one of the questions that, you know, I would ask is, for her it was wisdom, but what is it for you? What is it for me? What is it in our life that we look at that tree and we say, if I could just get some of that, it's going to fill me up. I'm finally going to be happy. And for Jesus, the pride of life was, I can show my glory. That's what the enemy was trying to get him to do whenever he brought him up on the pinnacle of the temple and he told him to cast himself down. What, there's an old rabbinical or rabbi tradition that says the Messiah will show up right there at the pinnacle of the temple. And so all Jesus had to do was to allow himself to come down and to float down in his glory. And he could have revealed himself to the whole world. He could have shown his glory to the whole world. And regarding the pride of life in our life, we all deal with this at various levels. It could have to do with, we don't like the way certain things look. And so they embarrass us. And we want to upgrade that situation. Whether it be our car, whether it be our house, whatever it may be. It could be other things. You can plug it in. You got your own brain. You can figure it out. Whatever it may be, the pride of life. It's just like, if I had this right here, it would just improve the way I look. And let us not feel as though we've arrived so much that we're not worried about the way that we look. Because the fact of the matter is that there's something on the inside of us, each and every one of us, to some extent, that wants to look a little bit better in the eyes of other people. And this is the situation that's going on. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And so it says that the serpent was more subtle than any of the beasts of the field which the Lord God had made. He said unto the woman, has God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? I thought this was interesting that the word subtle means crafty and sly. And that the word itself doesn't always have a negative connotation connected to it. Rather, it describes someone who is smooth and nimble on his feet. Someone who is clever, skillful, and resourceful. You know, one of the things that I started thinking about, the fact that he was subtle and they were naked. Now, to some extent, the nakedness and the fact that they didn't realize they were naked shows their innocence. They had never experienced sin before. The enemy had already had a history of experiencing sin. He had already had a history of experiencing deception and how to deceive other people. Because he himself, according to Isaiah 14, long before the world that we know was ever formed, had thought in his own heart, pride had lifted him up, and he said he was going to exalt himself above the throne of God. And the scriptures teach us that he brought a third of the angels with him. He brought a third of celestial creation, who once again are so far surpassing in intelligence than us. He deceived them into thinking that they would be able to go with him and find something that they had that was waiting for them in order to be gods, rather than to submit themselves under the one true God. And he was able to pull them away. And he was able to do that. He's quick on his feet. He's nimble. He's resourceful. He's crafty. I'm here to tell you, he's subtle. And at the same time, they were somewhat naked. But, you know, in Proverbs chapter 1, Solomon begins to explain to us purposes of wisdom. And the word wisdom, really, you could say, is a type of Christ, a type of the Lord Jesus himself as the Word. And it says right here in Proverbs, so the Proverbs definitely, or wisdom is definitely descriptive of the Word of God, and Jesus is the Word of God. It says in verse 1, the proverb of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment, and equity, to give subtlety to the simple. Are you simple today? Do you feel sometimes that, you know what, you just don't really always understand exactly what it is that you need to understand in order to gain victory upon this earth and in this travel that you're going through? I got good news for you. God gave you a book, and within it is a whole bunch of wisdom. Yes. Amen? Amen? And he's wanting to make you subtle crafty, nimble on your feet. He wants to sharpen your arrows. He wants to prepare you to be ready for when the enemy comes your way. He goes on to say, to give subtlety to the simple, to the young man, knowledge and discretion. So I got to also tell you that long before the lie ever showed up, God's word was already in effect. God had already spoken to them. Everything was good. This is the situation. This is what you have. This is where you go. This is where you don't go. God's truth showed up long before the enemy's lie ever did. So what we got to be reminded of is that we got to hold on to God's truth. We have to learn it. We got to hold on to it. Amen. What did David say? Your word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Amen. Yeah. The word reminds us. It's not just a matter of memorizing, but it's a matter of learning the context of the scripture. And it's a matter of, listen to me, when the enemy does sideline you, because he's going for a liver shot. I don't know why, but that word just hit my head. I was never a big fighter, but all of a sudden, the enemy's going for a liver shot. And so I Googled it. What's a liver shot? It'll incapacitate you. It's whenever they're going right for the right side of your rib cage, and they get up under your ribs, and they hit your liver, and they cause it to jiggle like that. And I'm telling you, it says that most men, the average man, it will incapacitate them. It'll cause you to go to huffing and puffing and breathing in a way. And they gave all kind of lists of people that went down with liver shots. I'm talking about one old boy just had his liver beat to the point that it was lacerated. And I mean, he had to have surgery in order to sew that thing back together. The enemy, when he shows up, I'm telling you right now, he's going for a liver shot. He's trying to take you out. And there's no question about it. That's what he wants to do. But at the same time, God, listen, God's the one that has the last say so. And I don't care how hard he hits you in your liver, the Lord will put breath back in your lungs. Amen. And what God wants to do with the word and even with temptation, I'm telling you, God uses him. He allows temptation. He wants to teach you something. He wants to resolve you. Don't you fall down and don't you go down for the count. When the enemy of your soul comes against you and he begins to deceive you and he begins to cause you to deviate in a way that you shouldn't go, don't you let him hit you with a liver shot and you go down for the count. No, you get back up, even if you can't breathe right, and you turn your eyes back to Jesus, the darling of heaven, the one who shed his blood, the one that died for you. Amen. The righteous one who gave his life so that you could have life. You get back up and you put your eyes on him and you hold on to him. And let me tell you something, you're going to learn something. You're going to learn something from what happened, from the subtlety and the craftiness and the nimbleness of that deceiver that came your way. And he's going to prepare you. God will prepare you. He will sharpen your mind. He will prepare you for this journey, for this battle that he's allowed you to be placed in. But the enemy of your soul, he wants to knock you out. He wants to be done with you. He wants to make you feel like a fool. He wants to make you feel unworthy and condemned. I'm here to tell you that in any of us left to ourselves, that's exactly what we are, unworthy and condemned. But oh, the precious blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The righteousness of our Lord and Savior. He's so beautiful. Amen.
Amen.
And so he's subtle. They were naked. But guess what? The word of God wants to give us strength. So one of the next things that I noticed was in Genesis chapter 3, verse 3, is that it says, starting in verse 2, the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. I titled this screenshot right here, Temptation is Everywhere. And one of the reasons that temptation is everywhere has to do with what Jeremiah said in chapter 17. He said, the heart of man is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? See, there's things on the inside of each and every one of us that we don't realize, and it comes from the fall. Just as soon as you think you've arrived, see, now you already got a problem because you got a self-righteous spirit. And listen to me, don't think that it don't try to jump on the preacher, because it does. It'll try to jump on every last one of us. You don't think you're okay. It's called the pride of life. It's called a religious spirit. You think because you know something that somebody else doesn't know that you've arrived or you know something. No, I'm here to tell you that right there, that spirit will blind you from what's really on the inside of you. So the Word of God already tells us that there's things on the inside of us that are not right. And that the heart of man can't even know the depth of the depravity that has resulted because of the fall. But let a temptation come in there. See, according to James, this is what James said. He said, let me turn to James real quick. James chapter 1, verse 13 and 14. James said this. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. So the idea here is this, is that whenever you get tempted of evil, you should not think that the evil aspect of it is really God giving that to you. God doesn't tempt mankind with evil, but God does allow temptation to take place. He allows the enemy to produce a circumstance, and God's purpose is that you would come out victorious. Amen? And the fact is, though, is that another thing that happens is that when the temptation shows up, what is revealed to you is something that's in you that you didn't realize that was there before. At least when the gospel is working properly in your life, there's things that are revealed to you. When a test or a trial shows up, it stirs something up and it allows you to see that something was there that maybe you didn't realize was there before. The way that you find victory over that is that you turn your eyes back to the Lord, back to the finished work of Christ. And what you do is you cry out to him in order to give victory in that area of your life. But it's in there. Mm-hmm. The lust of man is in him. It's part of the fall. And God doesn't himself give you the evil, but instead he does allow the circumstance to take place. And the enemy's plan for your life is to destroy you. But ultimately God can and will use it in your life to reveal to you things that were there and things that need to be dealt with. Amen?
Amen.
And so it goes on to say, one of the things that I started thinking about was, though, temptation is everywhere. And in this particular story that we're talking about, the garden, the tree, she said, was in the midst. And I started thinking, well, what does that mean? A tree in the midst. And so I looked up the word midst, and it's basically what I kind of thought. It was in the center, in the middle. So it doesn't really matter where you go. You could be traveling from the east to the west, from the north to the south. Any direction that you choose to walk in the garden, as you're just perusing along on your daily journey, minding your own business, watching the butterflies fly, picking fruit from all them trees that you can eat from, every time you turn around, there's that tree right there. I started to think to myself, I kind of started getting a little bit irritated, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm like, you can almost see yourself getting perturbed. Well, what in the world are you doing, Lord? What in the world are you doing? You're going to make this tree look so pretty. This tree looks so good. And it smells so good. And obviously, it was something that she desired so much. And there it is. It's not on the edge of the eastern side where they can just avoid it and just try to run from it. No, it's right there in the midst. It's right there in the very center of everywhere that they got to go. And here you go and you put it in there. Right there in the middle. And one of the first things that the Lord showed me was, hey, hold on. Don't blame the tree. The tree's good. I made the tree.
Right.
And I'll make the tree however I want to make the tree. I'll make it beautiful. I'll make it feel good. I'll make it taste good. I'll do whatever. The problem wasn't the tree. The problem was that they did something I told them not to do with the tree. And I can tell you that no matter where you go on this journey called life, that there will be something. You'll just be walking along dead to everything. The Holy Spirit working in your life, killing stuff. You hear what I'm saying? All that stuff that you used to deal with. Look, man, one time I was on a job in Venezuela, jogging down the road, and there was fruit that had just fallen all along the sidewalk. You could smell it. It was a mixture of a pungent smell along with a sweet smell between as that fruit rotted on the ground. And I'm telling you, whenever the Lord started setting me free from all of these various things I used to deal with, I got a memory of me jogging down the road in Venezuela and that fruit falling off the tree and just sitting there on the ground rotten and dead. And it was like the Lord started doing that in my life. It wasn't me working a program. It wasn't me taking a pill. It wasn't me going to counseling. It was the Holy Ghost showing up in the midst of my life. And I'm talking about sin falling from the tree. Hallelujah. But just as soon as you think that all the sin, all the fruit that fell off the tree, next thing you know, the Lord will allow, and there it is right there in the center. It's there. He'll observe you long enough. He'll watch you long enough. And if you're not careful, he will find it. And he will introduce you to it. And he will open your eyes to it. And the next thing you know, you will find yourself in the midst of another mess. And if it doesn't be for the Lord to show up in the midst of your mess and cause that thing to fall off just like everything else, you could be in for a whole world of hurt. And I'm just trying to encourage you to be aware that the enemy is slick. He's subtle. And he plays for keeps. So it was in the midst. But you know, the second thing I also saw was this, was that not only was that in the midst, but oh, hallelujah, look at verse 9 of chapter 2. It's raining out there. We ain't got nothing better to do. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 9, it says, "And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil." So not only was that tree in the midst, tree of temptation, tree that looked good, tree that was to be desired, but a tree that was not to be touched. There was that other tree there, the tree of life. I have to tell you, that tree is Jesus.
Amen.
There's no question in my heart, mine. And in each and every day, you and I embark upon this journey. There's going to be that test. There's going to be, in the middle of that garden, those two trees. And the Lord's pleading with us to grab a hold of the right tree. Amen? To grab a hold of the right tree, which is Jesus, and to hold on to him tight. Praise God. So the tree, the temptation is everywhere. The temptation is desirable. Verse 6. It says, "And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband who was with her, and he did eat." I just saw that, you know, we already kind of have, I don't want to belabor this point. We've talked about the fact that the temptation is always going to be something enticing, always going to be something that looks good. But I thought about King David just as another example of, and not, you know, we're not going to break down that whole story. We've read it and studied it many times, but Bathsheba, and how in 2 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 through 4, was it 2 Kings 11? 1 Kings. I guess I done lost my spot. Oh, it's 2 Samuel. Sorry. Thank you, Sean. I can always count on Sean if I lose my spot. 2 Samuel chapter 11. It says, "And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah, but David tarried still at Jerusalem." Well, there's already, when kings go to war, David stayed home. Yeah. Kind of in the wrong place at the wrong time. "It came to pass at an evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look on." She wasn't unsightly, she was beautiful. And it obviously sparked a desire in him, and he inquired of her. David sent men. Now this is a man of God. I mean, this you can do what you want with this, okay? You can pick on David all you want to. The Word of God says he was a man after God's own heart. David loved the Lord. And look what he did. He saw this woman, and he inquired about her, and what was told to him, he sent messengers, and it says right here, verse 3, excuse me, "And one said," who's one of the messengers, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" Now, David knew who Uriah was because he was one of his mighty soldiers. Uriah was one of the most powerful fighting men that David had. He's listed in the great warriors of David. So immediately he knew who the man was. But yet the Bible goes on to say this, he took her. He took her for himself. Even though he wasn't supposed to have her, she was forbidden. Nevertheless, he took her. So he saw her. She was desirable. He knew what he was doing was wrong. Yet nevertheless, he went the wrong way. And we know that it ended up being a situation that led to death because their child that she had conceived died. And we also know that God is merciful, amen, because he allowed their other child, Solomon, to be the throne upon which God promised. And from that lineage comes Jesus. Even in the midst of how bad your situation is, you need to understand something. God knows how to turn it around for good. Amen. It's never too late. Yeah. Amen. It's never too far gone. No matter what the enemy wants to tell you, he will try to convince you. He will try to condemn you. He will try to destroy you. He will try to kill you. He will hit you with a liver shot. But I'm here to tell you that no matter how bad it is, no matter how bad it looks, the Lord will turn it around and he will use it in your story to make you the person, amen, that he desires for you to be. So temptation is also desirable. Temptation will use people. It says in Genesis 3:6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, she ate, and she gave also to her husband who was with her, and he did eat. Temptation used her to get to him. I mean, it just is what it is. I mean, in my opinion, Adam did worse than what she did because she was deceived and Adam knew. It doesn't say Adam was deceived. He partook. Now, it's probably not a real healthy thing to do this, to speculate this, because the Word of God doesn't want to tell us. It tells us that he was with her, but really, we don't know how long of a period of time this was. It doesn't mean that just because she ate, she immediately handed the stuff to him and said, "You eat, honey, too." No. As a matter of fact, more than likely, I mean, once again, speculation, he probably waited because he knew it was wrong. And I was just thinking about the fact that if he did wait, I mean, because I'm just thinking about what sin does and how sin operates in the lives of people. I mean, we've been on the earth long enough. They didn't know anything. They were naked. They were blind to at least the effects of sin, the slyness of temptation. They didn't know any of that. And I just wondered, is it possible that Adam observed his wife and saw the change in her? And you know, for a period of time, sin will look very alluring, very enticing. And I wonder, did he wait a little while and see how it looked inviting and that it was something that he also desired because she was able, kind of like the songs do that we listen to entice us, to make us believe that what we want is what they got, you know? Or was it even worse than that? Was it even more sad than that? Had he kind of waited long enough to see her through that period, and then he started to see her decline, and he felt sorry for her because he loved her, and so then he chose to become like her? I don't really know. Then there's no way for us to prove any of that. But I do know this. I do know that Jesus, as he sat at the eternal Word before he became flesh, he observed his bride. He observed the happenings and the journeys of man. He observed what took place because of the fall inside of man. And the Word of God says that he became us, according to Hebrews 2:14. Because the children were flesh and blood, he also partook of the same. And it says also in Romans chapter 8, verses 2 and 3, where it talks about the law of sin and death, which, by the way, entered into the human race through this very act that we're talking about this morning. It says in Romans 8, verse 2, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh." Doesn't say that he became sinful flesh, but he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. He became us. He became a man. And he, without sin, condemned sin in the flesh. See, it was the flesh that partook of sin and changed their perfect being. Jesus became the perfect man and offered up that perfect life in our place, and he condemned sin in the flesh. So I just want you to know that temptation will use people. And so don't ever think that it's not true, that you got to be careful who you hang around with, and you got to be careful who you allow yourself to be around. The fact of the matter is that the enemy will use other people in your life. Temptation promises to fill a void. And basically, that's one of the things that I was trying to tell you about in Genesis 3:6. It also said, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to desire to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also to her husband. So, if you go back and you read in Genesis 1 and 2, you find that God provided them with everything that they needed. Gave them all the trees of the garden, all the herbs of the field. Yet she's left through the temptation believing that there's a void in her life. I know I've already actually hit this a little harder than I planned to on the early end. There's a void in her life, an emptiness that can only be fulfilled through the partaking of this tree. Even though it was something that God didn't give her, she feels as though she can take action and fill herself up and make herself feel more complete and make herself feel more full to come to a place of satiety, satisfaction. And I just got to tell you that Jesus wants to be that. I know it's easy. Oh, you say that's so easy, preacher. I didn't say it was easy. But I will say this. He's the only one that satisfies. Mm-hmm. He's the only one that'll always do you right. He's the only one that'll never do you wrong. Mm-hmm. Jesus is the same today, yesterday, and forever. And he loves you. Amen. Mm-hmm. And he wants to give you life. I want to close with Psalm 23. Just for whatever reason, it kind of was put in my heart when I was thinking about satisfaction and being filled. And trusting God. And so we'll just read that psalm real quick. It says, and then when I went back to read it, I realized why. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Amen.
The word want there really describes lack. It describes lack of fulfillment, lack of provision. And the psalmist is saying, the Lord is my shepherd. I wish I would have done my homework if I would have really had time and tried to find out whether or not Psalm 23 was written before or after Bathsheba. I don't really know, but I can tell you that the psalmist knew that the Lord was his shepherd. And that if he followed his path and he allowed him to guide him, that he would not want. He would not lack provision. Because you see, the shepherd, verse 2, will make me lie down in green grass, pastures. See, just like a sheep needs a green pasture to feed on, God's sheep, he knows what you need, and he knows what he needs to give you. He leads you beside still waters. Safety, tranquility, lack of chaos. God wants to bring you to a place, an environment that doesn't grow with thorns and thistles, but that instead has still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yeah, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, this earth is fallen and you're going to find temptation everywhere you look. I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Your rod, discipline. God will discipline you. He will chastise you like a loving father chastises a child. And thy staff, he will also comfort you. He will discipline you and he will also comfort you. Because you see, a staff is something that you got to lean on. That song lied when it said, lean on me. When you're not strong, he's going to let you down. Lean on Jesus.
Right.
Says right here, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And you anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.